welcome to the Albion Women's Show. I'm Dean Kilford, joined by the fantastic
Verity Gallagher. Yeah. What an introduction!
Yeah, you know.
Thank you. Well, on today's show, we have the goal stopper, Lucy Gillett.
Lucy, welcome to the show.
I'm good, thank you. How are you guys?
Good, yeah. Thanks.
But you've been a bit under the weather, so it's your first day out in over a week.
Yes, first day out. It's always a good day to come down to Brian.
what's been wrong? What's been happening?
Just a little chest infection, but
oh no,
I guess a good 2 weeks for it to happen.
Well, what's going on with the goalkeepers? We had Chloe on last time out and she's injured.
Yeah.
We've got you on. Are we a curse for goalkeepers?
Something that we're doing down in training, it must be.
So what has been happening down in training? Because you've had 2 weeks off, really.
Yep.
So what's been happening? What's the training been like?
Good 2 weeks off, obviously. Been training hard. Girls, they've added an extra session in last week, the last 2 weeks now. So adding more fitness into it, getting ready for Bristol this weekend, cup game, so should be a good one.
Confident?
Yeah, feeling good. Hopefully this week we'll do a lot of preparation for the specific game, get ourselves ready, get to know what our opponents are like.
It's got to be hard, isn't it? Because the season's sort of been in stages, like a group of games here, a couple of weeks off here, a group of games here, a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Is that hard as a player to sort of continue that momentum?
Yeah, it's complicated because the season started quickly and you had a couple of games and then you had a 2 week break. So you've got such momentum of, all right, game, training for a week, game, and then you've got the 2 weeks. But the staff do really well at sort of managing it and breaking it up. And when we have our breaks, we'll push a little harder for the 2 weeks and give us more time to recover and get ourselves back ready for, in this case, a cup game. So it just gives us extra time. But it's complicated when we keep taking big breaks.
Is it the fitness that you push harder?
I think that's one of the things that our team has as a strength. So there's always improvement that you can have in fitness. Any team could always improve their fitness. So definitely in the gym as much as we can be, and even out in the training field, we're doing well with getting fitness in there.
How does your fitness training differ to the girls, the other girls? Obviously, you're the goalkeeper.
Yep. I do a lot of, right now, I've got a lot of in the gym fitness going on, doing a lot of cardio in the gym.
And I've just joined you.
I'll show you what the workout's like then.
He just fell asleep in the bathroom apparently. Spent 20 minutes in there and had to get back up.
So I'll have our strength coach send you the HIIT sessions.
Yeah,
I don't think you're ready for that.
Get me in there. What's your coach's name?
Ivo.
I saw one of these. It looks
Ivo.
Hardcore.
Ivo.
Ivo, if you're watching.
Ask him for a gym session.
I'm ready.
So what are you more? You've got like agility, I guess, as well for you, quite a lot.
Yep. So on a Tuesday, I'm strictly in the gym doing cardio and a specific strength program. And then the rest of the sessions, I have my goalkeeper coach, John, with me. So that's when I get more of my goalkeeper specific fitness of more of those and my technical work in with him. But on a Tuesday, strictly conditioning and strength.
Technical as a goalkeeper, so when you think players technically with the ball, but as a goalkeeper, there's so much to it that you sort of don't think about positioning, how you even position your hand to save the ball to direct. How much do you work on the different elements of that? Is that a daily thing, a weekly thing?
Probably every session, it'll always be there, because any time you're playing, anything you do, it's always there. So it's more about the repetition and whenever the coach is there putting through different technical drills, and one day we might be focusing on something specific, more specific, so you'll break it down into different parts, but overall it's always there. So it's something a lot of players always say, oh, the goalkeeper, all you have to do is stand there, you don't do much, but they don't realise you sort of have to be ready for anything could happen. You might have to do a 1v1 one game, you might not have any in another game, but it's something you need to be ready for anything. So there's so much we have to be thinking about.
That's the thing, as a goalkeeper, you can have a game with nothing for 89 minutes.
Yeah.
If you make one mistake, it's going to likely be a goal.
And they look at it and they say, oh, the goalkeeper was sleeping or something. Yeah. But, no, it's all about concentration. Always have to be ready for anything. You could not have anything for the whole game and stoppage time, all of a sudden have to make a big save. So always need to be switched on.
So we spoke about this for the game. Yep. Did you always want to be a goalkeeper?
Yes, I did. I was put there when I moved to America. I think I was probably, when I was younger, the least fit on my team. So they put me in goal. Now it's kind of funny that most teams want their goalkeeper to be the most...
super fit.
Yep.
Agile.
The fittest person on the team. So I would say I've come a long way since since my starting first few days.
So you said move to America, so... Where did you come from originally?
Yep, so I did originally come from... Well, I was born in America. It's all very complicated. Born in America.
It's a good story there. It's a great story.
But I have two English parents. Born in America, right after I was born, moved back to England, lived here for 6 years, then moved back to America and spent my whole time growing up over there.
But what's interesting, though, is that you only started playing football... in America?
Yes.
The first 6 years?
Nothing. I guess that's... Obviously, I don't remember too much of my time over here, but football, from what I remember when I lived in England originally, football wasn't a thing. Mm-hmm. There was no... I don't know if that came from my parents or from the area I lived in, but there was no football for me. When I moved to America, I got straight in. That was sort of... My mum was looking for me to do something to get me... interacting with kids my age, and it seems like football was the thing that got me into
things. It's huge
in
the States, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Like soccer, certainly for kids, is the... I think it's the biggest participation sport of all the sports. When you consider, actually, in terms of where it's at, it's like number 4 or 5 behind like baseball, NFL. It's crazy.
It's gone up to third, I think, for most play sport for women.
Yeah.
But you moved to America in 1999. Is that right?
Yes.
So that is when America hosted the Women's World Cup.
Yes.
And won.
Yeah.
So it was on a massive high in America this time.
Yes.
So is it kind of just something you moved there and you just saw this kind of new sport that was kind of taking over?
I think, obviously, I didn't know much about the World Cup, obviously, because it's not like I'd really followed or played football before in 99, but I know all about it now from being involved in American football or soccer.
Soccer.
Everyone knows the story. Everyone knows sort of what that team did. And I'm sure that's when they pushed a big movement for girls and women to get into football in America. So that's probably when I was picked up and sort of started and then grew through the ranks in America.
How easy, because you said about how easy it is to find a women's team, because even still here now, the game's growing and clubs are doing a lot more to make football accessible for women. But over in America, it was easy, was it? You just went, oh, there's a team.
Yeah, I've thought it was funny that most people over here tell me, oh, I've played for the boys' school team until I was 13 or so. In America, I've played for a boys' team once. That's just because they needed a goalkeeper, so... I raised my hand for that. But I never had to play for a boys' team. I've always had options. I've played at sort of an advanced centre throughout school in America.
You're a scholar. Didn't you get that from football?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So I've never had any issues finding a team or being on a team. It's not like we just played recreational. We played... tournaments. I've traveled all over the US for different competitions, so there was plenty of opportunity, and I think that helped me.
You touched on this. You've got this great opening with young teams, but then you get to college level, university level,
yep.
And then what happens?
Well, this is what I think is interesting. It's so big when you're younger, and there's plenty of teams to play on, and I went to university over there. But once you're done... all the females just stop playing. So as soon as when you graduate uni, about 22, 23 years old, everyone just stops playing, and that's them retired from football. That's when I came over here because I knew I wasn't ready to finish.
Why is that? Why does everyone just seem to finish?
I think their league over there is still in the process of being grown. They've only got one league of, at the professional level for the women's team, and it seems it's in its fourth or fifth year, so it's growing. I think it'll take a few years until it's completely stable and ready to maybe, hopefully, like we have WSL 1 and WSL 2.
Well, we'll have to see how that goes. We're going to have to cut the commercial now, but it's been fantastic.
Yeah.
Join us after these ads for the second part of the show. Welcome back to the Albion Women's Show. We're joined by the fantastic Lucy Gillett. Lucy, we were talking about the American game before that, and it's still quite fascinating that despite how big the game is, the women's game over there, the professional level isn't matching that.
Yeah, it seems like there's definitely some really good players over there. With such a small league, they do have quite a few international players over there who are sort of, if you'd say, taking the American spot. So it's, they don't have as many homegrown players. And since the clubs don't really have academies working below them, which I think will all come in time, but they don't have academies, so they don't really start the girls off there at a young age. Most young girls in America, their main focus is get to uni and get to one of the top unis to play competitively there. They wouldn't think, oh, I'm going to really stick with this club so I can make their professional team. So there's more of a, it's more of a jump from when you graduate uni to move into a professional team. There's no sort of consistency going
forward. Yeah, that's the difference, isn't it? Because the college football is such a huge scene in terms of football, soccer, whatever competitive sport there is. It's that's the thing, and that's what I quite like that uniqueness.
It's how you make your breakthrough, isn't it? Yeah. Through, like, especially in the NFL, college football.
Yeah,
it's massive.
I want a soccer draft. That's what I want over there. But so you've decided to move away from the US.
Yes.
But before you came here, you made a stop.
Made a quick stop.
In Iceland.
Yep. I've played for a team in Iceland for, they do a summer league.
Can you say the name? What was the name of the team?
I actually don't know where to start. It begins with a K.
I can't even help you with it.
But apparently it's a shortened name, which we've learned today.
Just Fram.
Just Fram.
So you played for
Much
Fram.
Much easier. Yep. Played there for, they have a short season of just an extended summer, so about 4 months over there. Had a friend that is from Iceland that I've met in America. So I decided, why not go and live in Iceland for a couple of months, see what it's like.
Become player of the year.
Yeah.
Have a great 4 months.
Good. I think Iceland's a very great place. We've got to see some amazing, like the hot springs and everything. Everything you see on Instagram, on pictures.
It's actually real.
Yeah. it's real.
Were you out there for the Euros then? Was it that summer?
No.
No.
No. The Euro. No. Not for the Euro. I was here for the Euros.
Okay. So it was before.
The summer before that.
Yes.
I was at one of the qualifying. Because obviously Iceland's men's team's been doing really well recently. I was there when they qualified for the World Cup, so that was fun times, and it was such a small...
Cool.
Had Piteček there with Czech Republic, so it was interesting that after the game, sort of obviously I wanted to go and say hi to him. I could just walk up to him because the country's so small, you didn't have sort of barricades everywhere blocking you.
Amazing.
Just freely walk up to the other team and have a nice little chat. So,
What was he like?
Oh, very nice,
polite.
Yeah, they had just lost, so I didn't want to speak to him.
You weren't going to get much out of him.
And I know as a goalkeeper, it's not fun to lose. So, I've just had a quick chat with him, and he was, for having just lost, he was in great spirit.
Oh,
and
great,
very nice. Yeah.
And then from there, you put the call into Watford. Is that what happened?
I did. I'd come over here, and I'd contacted a couple of teams. I'd been into a couple of teams, and it just seemed like Watford was in the area that my family, because I still have some relatives over here, so Watford was in the more central area of where I sort of grew up and where my family still was, so it seemed like the best fit for where I wanted to be, where I had connections to help me out if I got lost, so.
You moved there, though, and they signed, I think, three goalkeepers in one day.
One day.
On the day that you signed, and you had six goalkeepers, yes. So five to contend with.
Yes.
What was that like?
It was interesting. I've never really had to train with so many goalkeepers.
It must have been bizarre.
I don't know how a goalkeeper trainer deals with six goalkeepers, because with one goalkeeper coach, you need more attention. But slowly, some of them left. So
you knocked out the competition.
I did knock out some of the competition. But having just got there, to have such a tight goalkeeper union, it felt good to have people that I was around every day. We had some good jokes, so it was sort of a welcoming.
I think you said in an interview somewhere else, actually, although there was six of you, you were all so friendly, and you didn't kind of, you know, obviously compete against each other.
It's an easy place for you to butt heads, because you're all fighting for, there's ultimately one spot for you, so you could quickly butt heads, but we all got along well, so.
That's nice when you move back.
And then you joined in the summer.
Yes.
But I think what we want to do now is throw it over to the Players' Challenge. So you took part in that, the whole squad took part in this. And we saw, obviously, last week Chloe did quite well. Let's see how you get on.
Hopefully well.
Lucy Gillett, number one, goalkeeper.
Three, two... One.
First attempt. It's the first time you've seen it.
It's the first time I've seen it. Oh.
Okay, so don't worry. Don't worry, I say. Don't worry.
There we go. I knew I did something.
Cheeky 3 points. Safe. You've got to be safe. Sometimes you've got to be safe.
Score a penalty.
Oh my God, well done.
Got a cheeky 3, 7 points.
You're doing well here.
Don't have a left foot, so.
Okay, so you guys already told me
that. Not bad. Seven points
is not bad.
So 7 points actually puts you into second place
on
the leaderboard.
Oh boy!
So second place on the leaderboard, which
congratulations.
Wow. Happy days. Got to be happy with that.
There's plenty of more people to come, but hopefully I can.
Can you hold on for the rest of the season?
See.
That's not a bad spot to be.
Thank you.
That's a good spot to be.
Yeah, you know, I'm not going to say I'm shocked, you've done
the
really
goalkeepers, man, they brought their A game.
Yeah, goalkeepers do.
We just stand there, we don't do much, do we?
Yeah. So you just practice your crossbar challenges and
so all we do.
So going to the squads, being at Brighton, kept a clean sheet on your debut.
Yes.
Got sent off in the second
game. I did.
We're still trying to work out what happened.
Yeah. I'm still trying. If anyone out there knows, just let me know what I did. I don't think that's sort of your ideal start to the season. I was telling Verity it was my first game with Hope on the bench with us, first game of her actually there with us, watching us. So I didn't know how my first impression went.
How was she with you after that? Did she as shocked as...
Yeah, it seems like most of the club were behind me and didn't really know, but we had to just move on. I knew I was suspended for a game, so quickly moved on, got that suspension out of the way and got back to things, kept working through it. For me, obviously, I was very shocked. I wasn't thinking. I was like, wow, we've got one win to start to the season, about to have our second win, and all of a sudden halfway or even a bit after halfway through, I get sent off, and I was like, oh no, what's going to happen? And are my coaches going to be mad at me, or is the team going to be mad at me? Luckily, we won the game, so it wasn't like my sending off affected anything. The girls were great. I was able to sneak out into the tunnel and watch the game. I was definitely very happy when we scored the third goal to seal that deal. But I mean, it was great that the girls sort of responded to that with so much sort of energy, that they can have 10 players on the field and still be doing what they do best, scoring goals.
This must have been so frustrating, because when you actually just don't know what's happened and you're not the kind of person, we don't meet you and feel like, oh God, yeah, she's going to get some trouble on the pitch.
No, there's always that player that you think, oh, she got another red card. All right, but I wouldn't say I'm one of those players
that you
would expect me to get a red card every game. So, and I was saying it was one of those games where I was nice and relaxed. I didn't have too much to do. I was probably one of the most relaxed I've been in the back there, but all of a sudden it just happened. I was like, what do I do? I even asked my teammate, went up to Kirsty, she was telling me it was all right and everything. And I said, what do I do now? Where do I go? I didn't know, I've never gotten a red card before, so I didn't know, do I have to leave?
Yeah, because Sophie came at you as well, didn't she? And they kind of just had to, like, one of them put your arm around you and just kind of escorted you.
I was like, I need to get my water bottle, then I guess I'll go and sit.
Just leave the water bottle, go.
Sitting in the changing room by myself, like, well, is anyone going to come in? Do I have to wait till the game's over? Can I go and sit outside? So I eventually got up and went and stood with the stewards at the gate entrance and had a quick look, so.
Running out of time, so I don't even think we're at time for this, but we're going to ask a few quick questions just before we go. So, US or UK?
In what regards?
Just answer the question, US or UK?
US.
US. Ooh, controversial.
What was your birthday present from your mum this year?
Oh, goodness. I do have a framed picture of my red card.
I love that.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah.
Seaside or countryside?
Seaside.
And what we'll say is dessert or mains?
Mains.
Lovely days. All right. Yes, Lucy, I think that's all we've got time for
thank
today.
Thank you so much for coming
on. Thank you.
It's been great. And we'll see you next week for another edition of the Albion Women's Show.